Today we're going to be covering another Justice League storyline leading up to the legacy when their children come back from the future. Today is going to be the story of time travel and a Groundhog Day-esque kind of situation. What if the Flash was able to watch individuals die within the Justice League, but had the ability to go back in time and change it? In our last video, we watched the Justice League battle against Tempest, the Timeless Mind. He sought to erase Earth from all known existence, and the team had to travel to different points in time with the help of Molly to stop Tempest's machines from destroying everything. In the end, Molly had deceived everyone to try and take the power for herself, claiming that there is something coming to Earth that must be stopped. Our news story? It begins in the ruins of Queens, New York, as Barry Allen begs for the dying Jessica Cruz to stay with him. As she draws her final breath, a voice shouts to him asking, "Why should he live when she didn't?" Barry looks up shouting, "What the hell are you talking about? She's dead! Dead because of you!" The man takes his device and he slams it into the ground, so the Flash runs up, touching it, and everything changes. Suddenly, Barry is in a diner with Jessica and he tells her that he ordered her usual. Three times, actually. He ate the first two while waiting. So she missed the big fight last night, huh? She laughs, telling him, "Yeah. She got held up fighting this guy who can make living shadows. He should have totally seen it. He was so bad." But while the two enjoy their breakfast, there's an explosion that rips through the diner. A voice calls out that he's going to tear them apart. All of them! And they're gonna pay for what they've done. Barry and Jessica suit up as the Green Lantern and the Flash. And as Jessica asks who is this guy, the Flash says that he's not sure, but he remembers something about him. She charges up her ring, telling the guy that she's not sure what he's talking about, but they're the good guys. They save people, and the man jumps into the air with his device, yelling that they aren't heroes. Because of them, his family is dead. He comes back down, using the device to stab into Jessica, creating another explosion. She falls back to the ground, and the Flash runs over, telling her to stay with them. She tells him that she's sorry. She's so sorry. Just like before, the Flash watches Jessica die again, and the man shouts, asking, "Why should you live when she didn't? Why?" The Flash gets up and he runs at the man, telling him that she's dead. Dead because of him. And as he touches the device, everything changes again. Except now, Barry is moments after meeting up with Jessica. She grabs his arm, stating that she figured that he would already be at the diner eating her breakfast right about now. And Barry says that he was, or did? What's going on? The two begin to walk towards the diner, and Barry says that they've done this before. The man from before shows up, but this time it is before the two of them even enter the diner. Jessica turns back, telling Barry to get back, but instead of letting her go first, he rushes towards the man and everything changes. He hangs up his phone after calling Jessica, and as he does, the man from before appears and attacks. The events continue to replay themselves over and over, each time with slight differences. There's one thing that Barry Allen does notice though, and that there's a building that has the same type of energy coming out of it. It's the same type of energy as the alien that they fought in Brooklyn. And the Flash runs inside of the destroyed building, finding the same man sitting there asking him, "What did you do?" The Flash tells him, "Wait, I didn't do anything." And the man shouts, "They're all dead! You killed them! This is justice!" And he slams the device down once more. But this time, the Flash runs and touches it, and he goes further back in time, back to when they defeated the alien. He stumbles out of the time jump, and Batman asks if he's okay. And the Flash tells him, "No. There was an explosion." Superman says he didn't hear one, and the Flash tells him it hasn't happened yet. It's going to happen soon. He's been having a sort of time travel Groundhog Day kind of thing. If they don't stop what's about to happen, then the guy's going to kill Jessica. Simon powers up his ring, stating that Jessica can't be dead. He would have known if something like that happened. And the Flash tells everyone, "Look, it hasn't happened yet. All I know is that there's this facility nearby that's going to blow up, and we have to stop him." Meanwhile, over at that facility, Jason Taylor meets with his wife Rose and their children just before Jason's big reveal. He asks Rose why she didn't get a sitter, and she says that Tony's wife offered, but she didn't feel comfortable with, well, you know. So Tony said that she could bring the kids. Jason sets his son down, stating he's so glad that they're here. He's just nervous right now. Rose tells him it's fine. He's amazing. And that's when Jason's boss Tony says that this is what they call him. Mr. Amazing. It is time for them to change the world. Jason says, "Yeah, about that, can we talk in private for a moment?" A short while later in the presentation hall, Jason explains to the people that they discovered how to harness zero-point energy into a single device. This device will allow them to control gravity and forces beyond them. It will revolutionize the military and their industry. Zero fuel costs for air travel. This device will take them to the stars. And just as Jason reaches for the device, the Justice League appears before him. Superman tells everyone, please, back away. We have it on good authority that this weapon of mass destruction will devastate the area. And Jason walks up to them stating, wait, my device is safe. You can't do this. The Flash gets close to the device and Cyborg says that he's getting an energy spike. The Speed Force is, and then an explosion goes off, destroying everything within the blast radius. Jason picks himself back up stating that he's gotta find them. Oh God, Rose, they can't be dead. And Diana starts to get up asking what happened. And the Flash says that he thinks that they caused it. That they are the reason for all of this. The Justice League killed his family. Jason grabs the device once more shouting, why do you get to live when my family didn't? That's not justice! And before the Flash can stop him, Jason slammed the device down again. As the light fades, we see Jason and Rose in their kitchen. And Jason says, I'm not the bad guy here. And Rose tells him, she's not saying that he is, but they've had this trip booked for 2 months. It's supposed to be their fresh beginning. Jason goes back to tying his tie and he says, you know, I got a call from Tony 10 minutes ago. They brought the project forward a month. They think that we're ready. Rose helps with Jason's tie and she asks, I don't suppose that you could have said no, huh? Jason then asks, why would I? This is a massive government contract. It could be worth billions. This is my project and my design. This could make our lives better. And Rose asks, is Tony going to be there as well? And Jason says, well, he is my boss. Rose gives Jason a kiss and tells him to go change the world. Jason says the world wouldn't be worth changing without her in it. Elsewhere, as the Flash opens up his eyes, he sees them fighting the alien from before. As he gets up, Batman asks, hey, is everything okay? You took quite a hit back there. The Flash rubs his head, telling him, no. No, why am I here again? This is before. Maybe we could stop it, change it before Jessica. And Batman asks, what do you mean? Save who? What are you talking about? While everyone begins to fight, the Flash gives Batman the rundown of what's been happening with the time jumps, and then the man that appears and the destruction that follows. The Flash says that he knows this all sounds crazy, and Batman tells him, not for us. Everyone should be able to handle themselves here. Let's go, Barry. A short while later, over at the facility, Batman says the weapon should be guarded, so they need to keep it from being triggered again to cause another event. As Batman begins to head in, the Flash makes a quick call to Jessica, and she tells him that she's a little busy at the moment. Flash tells her, yeah, can you, just call me back whenever? And as he hangs up, he says, okay, now I'm ready. The two sneak into the guard room, and as Batman begins to put on a uniform, he says that he's going to stay close to the weapon and its designer. Once they have Cyborg tapped in, they're gonna have him look through all of the relevant files on the weapon. Batman then heads into the halls, and the Flash radios back that he just took a long look through some of the files, and they state that they're looking for Jason Taylor. He should be the one not in a suit. Batman spots him, and just at that moment, Tony comes to check on everything. Back with the others, Cyborg receives the message from the Flash to tap into the systems, and he says to give him just a moment while he's accessing their location. Over with Jason and Tony, Tony asks what's going on. He's going to be going on in 5 minutes, and Jason tells him that he knows about him and Rose. She told him everything. Tony tries to deny it at first, and then he says that if she did, then she must have told him that it's over. Are you going to be okay? Jason tells him no, he's not okay. He hates everything, and he hates it more because it was with him. But him and Rose are working through it. They want to. Tony tells him that she's the one who broke it off. It was only a couple of times but Jason stops him, telling him, I don't want to hear it. After today, it won't matter. I've spoken with the general and he's agreed that if today goes well, I'll be getting my own department. And so when that happens, we're going to see how your department holds out. Batman asks the Flash if he got all of that. And he tells him yes. And Cyborg just got done scanning the system. Turns out most of the work emails have been deleted and are unrecoverable. But they did find one that was sent out about 10 minutes ago. All it said was the package will be delivered today, whatever that means. Back with the alien, everyone gets ready to move out of the facility, but Diana sees Aquaman just standing there. She asks, what is it? And Aquaman looks at the alien and says, now that it's quiet, I can sort of feel it. Panic. Fear. Like it's dying. Diana tells him that he's right. She can see the truth in it. Perhaps there's more to learn about this being. Cyborg then radios back that he just took a look at the files on the device and it turns out that it was built on alien tech. What's more, someone copied and transferred the files earlier. Someone named Tony Palmer. Back in the showroom, Jason begins his presentation when Batman walks up to him telling him that they have it on an impeccable authority that his device will go off and kill nearly everyone here. Jason asks him, what are you talking about? Let me check the... Oh God, it's on a buildup cycle, an energy pulse, one that could destroy the whole facility. Batman radios back to Flash to go ahead and prep an evac, and Jason says he can't stop it. It needs a higher authorization code. Batman says, Palmer? And Jason asks, Tony, why would he? Batman explains that it has been industrial espionage. He's been copying the device's specs, possibly to sell them. Jason says that there's no way that he would do anything like that. This device is one of a kind, built on an alien energy source. And Batman asks, what happens when the device goes off? And Jason tells him that the facility will be destroyed, but the device will remain untouched. Batman then says that he overheard his conversation with Tony about the affair. Tony asked for his family to be here. He's going to blow the place up with all of them in it. And Jason asks, what can we do? Seconds later, Cyborg boom tubes the rest of the team in there. The Flash finishes getting the last person out of the building and the device begins to become unstable. Superman tells everyone not to worry. I'm gonna take it up into space and... But before he can grab it, the device shocks him to the ground. Simon tries to contain it, but the device's effects just repel his green energy. Just as everyone tries to figure out what they can do, the alien from before crashes down, grabbing the device. Superman shouts, "We need to stop that alien!" And Diana tells him, "Wait, let it go." Aquaman says that he can feel it properly now. The device and the alien, it's harmony. They're two parts of the same being. Once the device is absorbed, the alien speaks, stating that his star heart has been returned. He goes on telling everyone that he is sorry for the attack. Without his star heart, all reasoning is gone. His name is Sentry, and they guard the Darklands border and prevent incursions. The star heart was sent to investigate the Kindred signal. However, he must go. They must guard their own borders. It is upon them. Later, as everyone sits down for dinner, Jessica asks, "Wait, I died?" And Barry tells her, twice actually. We got it all sorted out though. Cyborg explains to the alien, that was a warning. And Batman says, "It's not the first, is it? Ever since the Kindred, we've had other beings. The Fear Thing, Molly, the Timeless, the Sentry. All of them warning us about something. Something is coming. We all need to get ready for whatever it is." And there you have it. As usual, if you're wondering, it's not the greatest Justice League stories, but I do enjoy these. They weren't that bad. I was just expecting more, but we're getting there. Next, we're going to be discussing what happened to Aquaman, and then we're going to be talking about the Justice League's children from the future. That's right, you heard me right, and if you want to know that storyline, subscribe to the channel. And don't forget to press the little bell button down below to get notifications as to when things go live or what's happening on this channel. That little bell button really helps us out. You can also find me on Twitter, where you'll get single tweet reviews. Whenever I read a comic book, I take an image from it and then tell you my thoughts about it on Twitter. And they gave me 280 characters. I can say a lot now. And you can also find the Justice League playlist right here. I hope you guys enjoyed, and I'll see you next time.